Today's the day. AMD's RDNA2 refresh is finally launching. I'm going to be checking out the 6750 XT for this round of updates, so stick around. Let's see what the changes are and how this might affect your choice of GPU if you are in the market. Welcome to Machines & More. It's been a long wait, but GPU prices are finally looking a bit more reasonable now, so it's been a much better time to consider an upgrade. About a year ago, we checked out the Nitro Plus 6700 XT, and at the time, it was a pretty big question mark since the availability then was so scarce and pricing was unknown. But this refresh launch, it's gonna come at much better timing. Prices have been trending much closer to MSRP, and on the AMD Direct Buy site, you can even fairly reliably find that 6700 XT reference model in stock. Sapphire provided the test card today. This is their Nitro Plus 6750 XT, so big thanks to their help here. And I'll dive right into the refresh changes here. We'll get into some performance benchmarks, and then I'll highlight some features on this card here, and then I'll close with some thoughts on the 6750 XT in general. Okay, so first off, three new SKUs. We have the 6650 XT, the 6750 XT, and the 6950 XT, which are the replacement versions for the 6600 XT, 6700 XT, and the 6900 XT, respectively. But today we'll hone in on the 6750 XT specifically. It is an incremental change, as the numerical progression would suggest, and looking at the reference specs from AMD here, other than a small bump up on the frequency side, the big change here is the memory speed. So going from 16 gigabits per second to 18, the memory bandwidth increases to 432 gigabytes per second. Along with a bump in core clock and the memory clock comes an increase in total board power consumption. We are looking here at 250 watts spec, even though that figure is going to depend on the board partner, and at least with the Sapphire Nitro Plus card at stock levels, the 6750 XT hovered around 210 watts, while the 6700 XT hovered around 180 watts. So a 20 to 30 watt bump up nonetheless, but the power target, it's gonna be a little more conservative here on the AIB side versus the reference spec. I think either way, 650 watts for your power supply, it's gonna be completely adequate. For an extended run in Heaven 4.0, the difference in boost clocks is actually a lot higher than the reference specs though. The 6700 XT Nitro Plus boosted to about 2575 megahertz. The 6750 XT from Sapphire, it does appear to be nicely overclocked at about 2750 megahertz. So there's quite a nice OC in place of the VBIOS. Of course, that is coming with the extra 30 watts of draw here versus the 6700 XT. Now, as expected, the memory clocks on the 6750 XT are a bit higher, while the 6700 XT came in at 2000 megahertz. The new card comes in at 2240 megahertz, with a 2300 megahertz ceiling in the VBIOS if you are doing an OC. And we'll touch on that briefly towards the end of the video. All cards were tested in the NR200 test system here, running the 5800X, and where possible, case fans are employed to aid the card's cooler fans. Not here though, because come on, this is a huge card. And we'll cover the cooler design after we check in on the benchmarks, but yeah, no case fans underneath this card here. So one last note is that I did test the 6700 XT last year when Sapphire sent it by, so I am unable to retest that right now. But overall, it's the same test system and things are kept consistent, so it should give a good idea of where things stand overall. So with those modest spec bumps, we're not expecting to see an earth-shattering improvement here, and you know, diving into the synthetic benchmarks, we actually see quite a big jump. For TimeSpy Extreme, which is a 4K benchmark, the VRAM is going to factor in a lot more. And that looks to be quite a good boost here. Almost exactly the amount of the memory bandwidth increase, about 12%. The refresh does get the AMD card a little bit closer to the 3070 from NVIDIA, but for Port Royal, which is a ray tracing benchmark, we're still going to see quite a gap here, and both NVIDIA cards still have the upper hand in ray tracing. Still a decent bump up over the 6700 XT nonetheless. Where you'll see a little bit less difference is in something like Heaven 4.0. This is benched at 1440, a modest bump up here, and with superposition and 4K optimized, about a 10% increase here. So based on the synthetics, we get an idea of where the refreshed card stacks up. So going into the gaming benchmarks, I'm going to stick to 1440p. Since that's where this card is positioned, I think this is a really ideal resolution for this card. Wolfenstein Youngblood, small improvement over the 6700 XT. Nothing mind-blowing. Watch Dogs with RT off, it's just a tiny bit better than the card it's replacing. But unfortunately, with RT on high, I think any of these cards will still struggle to get you playable frame rates, but you can see here the NVIDIA cards are better at RT. Of course, in a scenario like this, you might want to employ RSR for compatible Radeon cards, which is the RX 5000 and RX 6000 series, where you can then set the resolution to something lower, like 1080, and AMD's technology will upscale it to your monitor's native resolution. So DLSS is similar from NVIDIA, but RSR is compatible with far more titles, and RSR will work as long as the API is compatible. So the 6750 XT, like the 6700 XT, is fully compatible here, and the resulting image, you know, it's okay, although you can still tell it's not as good as the native resolution. But with DLSS versus RSR, your 3060 Ti and 3070, they're still going to be better in this scenario. Far Cry 5, a little bit of a boost. Frame time consistency has a little change here. Civ 6 Gathering Storm, no real change here. Red Dead 2, same story, run-to-run variation here. AoE 4, now this wasn't around when I tested the 6700 XT, but here we still get a good idea. A little worse than the 3060 Ti with better 1% here. So at least based on this particular AIB card, depending on the title, you might see an unnoticeable improvement, and in titles where it does seem to matter, around about 5% I'd estimate. When you consider that the power consumption is about 16% higher, then you almost want a little more, right? But at this end of the curve, it's never gonna be one for one anyway. I still think it's a solidly 1440p card, and it's quite a good one. This type of memory upgrade isn't going to make 4K that much more playable than the 6700 XT, and if RT is a priority here, I would still lean towards either the 3060 Ti or the 3070 here. So onto this particular card itself. Even on the chip side, the changes are minor. This particular AIB card has some big changes, and emphasis on big, because the 6700 XT Nitro Plus was what I would consider your 2.5 slot card, you know, just slightly more than the 2 slots that it occupies. This one's, it got thick. It's basically 3 slots now. It's still a long card, and it's still got that substantial flow through section that overhangs the PCB. And I did have to take out the lower rib of the NR200 test system to get this one in, but yeah. This thickness, it does absolutely preclude case fans in that case, below the card in the test case. The fan system is quite similar, if not the same. You still have two outer fans that spin counterclockwise and one that spins clockwise, and the fans are quick connect ones and easily replaceable. The performance is excellent too. Put it this way, for the duration of the thermal testing, the fans, they wanted to settle in at around 1500 RPM. Which is 32% of the PWM curve for the fans. It's really, really, really tame acoustically. So overall, it's a really impressive cooler. You got 3 display ports, 1 HDMI, no USB-C, very well built card. So I'm not sure that the increased power consumption necessarily warrants such a huge cooler. We are talking still only about 220 watts here. It does have a dual VBIOS switch, which toggles between a quieter fan mode and a standard fan mode. With as quiet as the card ran in the normal performance mode, I would absolutely recommend just leaving it in that setting. And taking a look at the thermal differences here, just a word of caution, the fans here are about the same RPM level, but here the 6700 XT did have the benefit of case fans under it, which does help pretty significantly. And looking at the temps here, there's really nothing alarming, and it's not gonna change anything materially in terms of the boost clock. And if it's topping out at 70 degrees or 65 degrees, it's not really gonna be a material difference for the boost clocks. This card is still holding the boost clocks that it got to initially fairly consistently. So the cooler is doing an absolutely bang up job here. With this good of a cooler, an OC is entirely possible. It's already pushed quite a big amount above reference spec. So the VBIOS, it does limit the core clock to 2900 megahertz and the VRAM to 2300. At that level, your gaming stability is gonna vary based on the title, but just using a synthetic benchmark here, like Heaven 4.0, you can get an idea of what that additional performance looks like. This did require an extra 10 watts of power to the card. The cooler is entirely capable though, because the fans here, they only have to run at about 200 RPM higher, little bit more noise, but the temps are still well under control. I think it would have been fine for Sapphire to have stuck with the same cooler, but for those of you with space or a larger case, I think the new cooler design is quite welcome. And there you can also take advantage of the anti-sag support bracket that Sapphire is now including. So all around solid AIB option, it's a quality PCB, it's typical Nitro Plus high-end feeling card and cooler, and I think if you are going to go for the 6750 XT, this one would be at the top of my list if you have the space, and that's the kicker here, since it is a critically larger cooler than before. MSRP for this particular card from Sapphire is going to be $619 US. I believe that's going to come in about $60 to $70 more than the reference MSRP, which is typical for Sapphire's Nitro Plus cards in terms of where they're positioned, since they do feature very high-end cooler designs, and you also have the RGB lighting here. The price comparison against the 6700 XT Nitro Plus card, it really won't be valid in a few months, and as inventory clears out, it's not going to be a current SKU anymore. But for reference, at least right now in Newegg, you can still get the older card for about $570 in the US. So that does bring us to some closing thoughts on the 6750 XT in general. It's going to come down to whether or not you can snag the card at the MSRP or not. And I know that's been the general conclusion in the last 2 years of GPU reviews, but you know that prospect is going to be a lot more likely now. In this price range, you do have the 3060 Ti, those AIB cards, which are mostly around the $600 mark now. And for traditional rasterization, I think the 6750 XT, it's going to be a better card unless ray tracing or DLSS is a priority. And even though DLSS is great, you do also have to consider that AMD's RSR upscaling will work with pretty much every modern title. And that's going to be, you know, way more titles than DLSS. So it is replacing the 6700 XT, like I mentioned. So at some point, you won't have a choice. But for me, the math is pretty simple right now. We're looking at somewhere around a 10 to 15% increase in pricing. And perhaps for certain titles, you will get that back in added performance. But I'd expect less than 5% for most titles at 1440. And at least where this card is positioned, that's going to be hard to notice. So if you're shopping in this price bracket, I'd say if you can still get the 6700 XT while inventory is still here, it's a decent deal. Sapphire is going to continue offering their Pulse 6700 XT while the inventory lasts. And even though it's an outgoing SKU, this is the first time it's realistically been available at or close to MSRP. So I think it's a decent deal right now. Not that the 6750 XT refresh is a bad card. I think it's absolutely fantastic. And I think if you can get it at MSRP, and here's the thing, right? I don't know if you can or will be able to just yet, but let's assume yes. And then I think you'll be quite satisfied. Unfortunately, it is a little bit of a price increase in disguise, part performance increase, but you know, all around, it's going to be a solid card. So if you enjoyed this review and found it helpful, please subscribe if you haven't already. Give a like. I'll leave links down below as they become available. And thanks for watching today.